Welcome back to Nexperia Power Live. You're watching our live GAN channel. We're about to start with our fourth session of the day.
Here, live with you, are Manikant and Giuliano. They will present their plan on making robust GAN devices and going beyond AEC-Q 101 to cover wideband gap needs. The session will be around 25 minutes, first a presentation and then questions. Questions are anonymous and you can ask yours using the question pane on the right-hand side of your screen. So please go ahead and ask your questions to the experts or share your own experience and insights. And with that, I'll hand it over to Manikant and Giuliano to begin. Gentlemen, please take it away.
Thank you. Welcome everyone to session on quality and reliability. My name is Manikant. I am GAN quality architect based in Manchester.
Hello to everyone. I'm Giuliano Cassatro, and I'm responsible for the GAN marketing and commercial activity. I'm also based in Manchester, and today I'll be taking care of your questions related to commercial topics. Thanks. Over to you, Manikant.
Thank you, Giuliano. Right. So before we go into discussing quality and reliability for gallium nitride and what activities we do at Nexperia, let me give you a snapshot of different GAN products we have. So the first one is a 650 volt product, which is in a TO247 package. We have got two products in this category. There is a 63 milliohm part and there is a 41 milliohm part. Both of these products are qualified to industrial standards. The second one which we have got is a 650 volt product, and that comes in a copper clip package. Now there are two variants for this product. There is a bottom side cool part and there is a top side cool part. And this product will come in a 39 milliohm as a product. Now this product will be qualified as per AEC-Q101 requirement. Now, coming back to the content and the focus for this session. So we are going to give you details of what we do for quality and reliability at Nexperia for gallium nitride. So I thought I will use Barth Turf curve, which basically gives you failure rate versus time. To use this as focus of my presentation. You can define this curve into three different regions. Region one being the infant mortality or the early failures. Region two could be the useful life. And region three, which is end of life or the wear out region of the curve. So throughout this presentation, I will share with you what different activities we are doing at Nexperia and what firewalls we are adding to protect our devices within these three different regions. So let's go through. Before, how do we make our products at Nexperia? So in this slide, I'm trying to explain to you the journey of our product. Now, at Nexperia, we make Cascode GAN product, which means we use a silicon FET and a GAN HEMT, and they go together in a package. So the very first thing we do is we do the concept phase, right? And that's where we think that we can make a product for that given application, right? So that's how we start, or the early design phase. Then we go on and do our specification, right? So at this stage, we define the technical concepts that could be for product, could be for package, or could be for the whole manufacturing line. And then we come up with our validation plan that if this is the spec we want to meet, then we must test and qualify it to at this given level. And we'll do all our design for excellence and risk assessment using FMEAs and put a plan together. So that's the specification phase, or what we call as specify. Then we go on to freeze. Now at this point, you have built some prototype samples. You have done some testing, and that could be some dynamic or static testing. And then you go back and revisit your risk assessments, whether you need to add more mitigations or have you narrowed down your high-risk items and have got good action plan against them. And if you feel everything is right, then we go and freeze our build of materials. We also freeze our assembly and device processing facilities. And then we move on to the next stage, which is validate. At this point, what you're doing is you're testing your product to the specification which you defined earlier, whether the product meets all the test standards you want, whether it meets all the qualification standards it should, and ensure that everything is ready, not only for small, but for large volume production. And that's where you say you have done the validation right. And if everything goes well at that point, then we go and do release. That is, we make sure that we have done the safe launch, we have tested the product, validated it, and it's ready for mass manufacturing. So this basically is a snapshot of every activity which we do at Nexperia for gallium nitride. So let's go back to bathtub curve. As we said, we will go through different regions and talk what we do at Nexperia for each of these. So starting with the first one, which is infant mortality. Now, gallium nitride, we all know, is a new technology. And often when you start with a new technology, there is bound to be some design weakness or some issues with your manufacturing or in your processing. So to screen out those early immaturity in your process or in your design, what we do is we have added a screening test. Now, as I said earlier, our GaN device is a Casco device. So we have got a silicon FET and a gallium nitride HEMT. So we have screening test for both of these devices. And we make sure that every product which we make at Nexperia has this firewall. So it's a production level screening test, and every product goes through this. And that really protects our product against any immaturity in design, processing, or manufacturing. And that's how we protect any early failures in our process. The second one is the useful life. Now, you have already taken out any early weakness in your process and design. And the understanding is, by this point, you must have a stable process, whether it is manufacturing, design, or processing, right? So what you're doing, basically, you're saying that we have taken out early failures, and now we are ready to do testing to a standard. And that standard could be an AEC Q101 Revision E being latest, or it could also be an industrial, where you have things at Nexperia, like an Nexperia Reliability Qualification Standard, which is basically a collection of tests based on JEDEC or other wide bandgap requirements. Now, the question at this point, especially for gallium nitride, is most of these tests, whether it is AEC Q101 or the JEDEC standards, are primarily for silicon devices. So if you are testing a GaN device just on these standards, is that sufficient, or we need to do more? Right, and that is the question which everybody keeps asking, including experts from industry. So what we have done at Nexperia, especially in this useful life or the region two of the bathtub curve, what we say is we will test two given standards, whether it is AEC Q101 or it is JEST47. All the existing standards will have to be met, right? So every product we make meets the standards in AEC Q101 or JEST. What we also say, and just to give that confidence that the product we are making is robust enough, we will extend these tests. So for example, we won't do these tests only for AEC Q101. We will take this test beyond AEC Q101. So it could be one time, two time, or more than that. So these tests will be extended beyond the standard durations. What we also do is we have got a zero defect program, which means everything has to met to be to Six Sigma standards, and there has to be enough actions done in order to have a right safe launch. So everything which is in the existing industry standards has to be met. That's the minimum requirement you have to do. What we have also done, and because we are actively involved in different wide bandgap forums and we continuously interact with our customer, is we have added a lot more tests which is not part of any AEC Q101 requirement or any existing standards requirement. And I will take you through a few of them, starting with H3TRB, which is basically high temperature, high humidity, temperature reverse bias test. Now, if you look into AEC Q101 or the current standard, it says if the product meets 100 volt specification, then it is a pass. Now, what we have said is we won't do that. We will take our products, will not limit it to what AEC Q101 says or 100 volts. We will take it to rated voltage. So for example, a 650 volt product will be tested up to 650 volt. And that is not part of the AEC Q101 requirement. It's actually going beyond that. That's the first one. The second, if you look for tests like high temperature reverse bias, which is HTRB, or even H3TRB, both of these tests are static in AEC Q101. And by static, I mean the specification is you apply 650 volt in reverse bias and at a given temperature, and you keep the device in that state for thousands of hours, for example. So that's a static measurement. Now, we all know it's a switching device, gallium nitride. So what we are saying is we will not be doing this test in static mode. We'll actually be doing this in dynamic mode. So what we'll do is we'll not only fix the bias at 650, we will keep running them at 300 kilohertz, for example. And that frequency can be tuned for the application we are targeting at, right? So it's not a fixed frequency. And that gives us more information on how well dynamically our devices are, not just statically. That's one of them. The next one is dynamic RDSON. Now, those of you who know about gallium nitride know it's one of the most important parameters. And what dynamic RDSON It's basically a ratio of your static RDS on with respect to change in that RDS on every time you turn off and turn off the device, turn on the device again. Now, it's important parameter, and therefore what we say is that we will not only measure dynamic RDS on, we will measure this dynamic RDS on as part of our live tests. So any test we do, such as thermal cycling or HTRB, we will monitor this parameter for our device. And that really gives us information on how this dynamic RDS on is changing with respect to humidity or voltage stress. And that's really important, especially if you want to really say that your gallium nitride device stands out. The other one is mechanical stress. Now, as I said earlier, we are using a silicon FET which sits on top of gallium nitride FET, right? And GaN being piezoelectric, you really want to know how much stress your device can take, right? And as I said earlier as well, we are making this clip bonded product into two different categories, the top side and bottom side. So you want to know how mechanically robust your product is, right? To what extent can you apply mechanical pressure while mounting a heat sink or in different applications. So what we are doing as part of this test is we have developed some in-house testing where we apply a known mechanical stress on the product while we are electrically testing all the parameters. And that really tells us how mechanically robust our product actually is. So you can see we are not just doing what is specified in AEC-Q101 or in JST. Based on these interactions from customer, we are trying to add a lot more tests, which is not part of any defined standards. And that really makes our product more unique and more gives more confidence that it is really robust in a dynamic environment. So these are the activities which we are doing for useful life. Now let's move on to the third region, which is the end of life testing or the wear out region of the device. Now you have really proven by having screens and test to standards in the region one and region two that your product is robust enough, right? It meets all the defined specification and it also goes beyond. But what you really want to know, at what point these devices fail, right? What are the failure modes which might exist, right, in these devices? You want to know that information as early as possible so you can go back and fix those problems in your design or in your manufacturing. What we have done is to address this region, we have got a dedicated team at Nexperia, which is led by Sara Horcajo, who is the leader for that particular reliability team, which focuses on testing this part, on the wear out and test to fail approach. What basically we do as part of this test is we focus on three different things. Electrical, and that is really to find out what failure modes may exist if you're trying to push power and performance through these devices. The second one is thermomechanical, right? The idea is to find out what failure modes might exist in manufacturing, in packaging, and in whole of the packaging assembly. And the last one is ultimately these are switching devices. So you want to really run them in the real life or real application scenario and find out what failure modes are there or what might exist and what could be a lifetime for a given switching test. So these are the three areas where we are really targeting with the test to fail approach. So let me give you a brief about what tests we are doing to find for more information. So starting with electrical, right? So as I said earlier, the aim here is to really push the power and performance of the device. So for example, we'll be doing tests such as high voltage off state stress, which is HVOS. The idea here is you take a device, for example, in this case, we have taken a 650 volt device and we have really pushed that device much beyond that, right? So the idea is to keep going to a point when they start failing. Now, you really want to know at what point do you say the device has failed, right? Or it started to degrade. So we also use a different metric on judging whether a device is still good or not. For example, we say because this is an off-state test, we say if there is a more than 20% leakage from your 650 volt or the standard conditions, then you can treat that device has already started to degrade. So the idea here is that you keep pushing this device to a point they fail. And so you have change your voltage. You do the same experiment by changing your temperature, right? So you have got change in voltage, change in temperature, and then you can work out your viable or log normal distribution and find out what is the activation energy for that failure mode and what voltage parameter. And then you can work out how well, what that failure mode is, from where exactly it is coming, and then you can go back and try to fix that. So this is one area how you try to really push the power and performance of the device and find out a failure mode. The second approach is thermomechanical. Now, in this part, we use two different tests, thermal cycling and power cycling. Now, some of you will say, well, thermal cycling is also used in standard tests. For example, AEC-Q101 says that product must meet thermal cycling from minus 55 to 150, for example, for 1,000 cycles. Now, remember, here we are not testing to standards. The idea here is to really push these devices and make them fail. So with thermal cycling, which we will do for this particular part, we'll start from reference point of AEC-Q101, for example. So we'll go beyond that. So we'll do the testing at 175, 190, or even 200. The idea is to really stress these devices thermomechanically and make them fail, and then find out what that failure mode is. Right. So we'll use the same approach for thermal cycling and power cycling, where you use a delta TJ of going beyond the required standards and really push these devices to fail. And then you can use similar approach as earlier. You can say, if the RDSON changes more than 20%, then the device has already started to degrade. And you can use the power law because you know what your accession factor is from that changing temperature. And you can again go back and work out your viable error or your log normal distribution. And so that really gives you a handle on what sort of failure mode which may exist in your manufacturing or in your packaging using combination of these two tests. So that's how we do our thermomechanical test and test to fail, and really pushing these devices beyond the standard or beyond the standard operating conditions. The next one is operating life. Now, again, this is a switching device. So the idea here is to basically make an AC or a DC farm, put arrays of these devices, and really apply maximum load across by changing different range of bias conditions and also pushing beyond the operating conditions and find out in actual real application at what point those devices fail, right? At what point they start going to degrade and they really are not working as they should. So you are making them switch as they would in real application and not just a small sample set, but a large sample set, and trying to find out what failure mode do exist in real switching applications for our devices. So all this while I have been talking that what test to standards we do, what we have done, and what we are also trying to add more tests. So here is one example. As I said earlier, we have qualified two products in TO247. So here is one example, which is a GAN 41 milliohm part. This product is in a TO247 package. And you can see here, this product meets all the standard tests required, right? For example, thermal cycling for 1,000 cycle, it passes. Intermittent operating life for 15K cycle passes. And HTRB, which is really important to stress the GAN-HEM device, it meets the 1,000 hours requirement. So this product really meets all the standard requirements which you would expect from a good qualified AEC-Q101 device. But what it also does is we have taken this test beyond the standard, right? So we are not just stopping when it passes AEC-Q101. We have really pushed these devices beyond that. So for example, you can see thermal cycling, this device has already passed 4,000 cycles, which is basically four times the standard requirement. And we have not stopped these tests. Now, as we speak, these tests are still ongoing. And the aim is to keep running them and to a point when they start failing. And then you can find out why exactly it fails, what is the failure mode, and then you can go and work on them. So the aim is to really make a robust device. And same thing happens for IOL or for HTRB test. Now, you can also see that there are a lot more tests like gate bias and other tests, which we have done just two times and stopped. And the reason being, most of these gate bias tests are basically trying to find out how good the silicon device is. And that's where NXPedia expertise comes in. We have been making these silicon devices for the last 20, 30 years. So there's a lot more information on failure modes and how do they perform beyond their standard requirements. So there's a lot of knowledge which we can tap into. And therefore, our focus remains mostly around gallium nitride and the package. So that's why we have kept the focus on HTRB, thermal cycling, and IOL. The idea that we can get more information on these products and really keep pushing them to a point they fail. And same approach we will take on CC pack, right? When we qualify the CC pack to AEC-Q non-standard, we will again extend these tests to beyond the standard requirements and actually all the way till they start failing. And that will be true for both variants. So we'll do the same for top side as well as bottom side cool. So not only we have just made our qualification strategy by adding more tests from wide band gap, we are actually going and executing these things. And that really gives us a nice picture and more confidence in the product which we are making here in Xperia. Now, so if you want me to summarize what we have done so far and what the Xperia quality and reliability product for a product looks like, we are trying to address every region of the bathtub curve. right? So what we are saying is we will test to a standard. We will make sure that we are testing as per AEC-Q 101 or JEST-47. Whatever existing standard are there, we will make sure that our product meets that standard, existing standards. So there's no question or compromise on that. What we're also doing is we are part of different wide bandgap forums. We are part of JEDEC committee as well, which is JEC 70.1. And with based on regular interactions from them and any new test which comes up, for example, JEP 180, we keep on adding these tests. So we make sure that we are tapping into the knowledge which exists on wide bandgap forums and any test which might make our product more robust and better. We are adding that as part of our qualification. The third one is we are continuously interacting with automotive customers, right? To understand where exactly they are putting these products, what is the targeted application? What test can we add to give them more information that this product will work very well in that given application? So there's a lot of test which is coming purely based on customer interaction and the targeted application. Also, if there is any known failure mode, or if there's any particular GAN specific test, then we want to add that already so that we get that information as soon as possible. We don't have to wait all the way for end of the qualification. So we are adding customer specific test and also application specific test where these products will be aimed at. And the last one, we don't just want to stop at that point. No, we know that we meet the existing standards. We know that we have done knowledge for test for gallium nitride specific failure modes. We know that we have tested for a given application. But what we also want to do is we don't want to stop at that point. We really want to push these devices and get them to fail, to find out what's the lifetime of our product, what failure mode exists in our product, and how can we fix them as soon as possible before having failures in real field or real applications. So there's a dedicated program which is just targeting the reliability and which will give us a lot more information in terms of lifetime models, failure modes, and everything. And that these four key points basically sums up everything which is happening at Nexperia in terms of how we make our product robust enough that gives more confidence to customer, even though it is a new technology, and that's really needed. So if you want to know more, you can visit nexperia.com/GANFETs. We have added a lot of quick learning videos, which gives information on how to read high voltage or gallium nitride data sheets. Also, giving you information in terms of what advantages are there for copper clip or surface bound packages. We keep regularly updating the technical notes or white paper, which we have based on product robustness and test which we do. So please do visit. We can find more information there. And yeah, that really concludes my presentation. I'm open to any questions or feedback. Thank you.
Thank you, Manikant. Great presentation. Yes, we actually do have some questions. One about the JEDEC committee that you mentioned here. Will you share the test results with that JEDEC committee?
We'll do. So the plan is that once we start having these results, and we would like to put these informations out there as well and share with the team, and not just with the team on Wide Bandgap Forum, but also to a wider audience, right? Yeah. To learn more about what everybody is doing and really put take a lead on that and saying that our products are actually going beyond the requirements.
Okay, great. Next question here. Will you provide data from tests to fail for every product?
That's a good one, yes. So we will try to use a structural similarity. For example, if the CC pack has got bottom side and top side cool part, we will do tests on both of them. But of course, we will use structural similarity where we can find out if the package is similar, for example, then we may not need to do all the packaging tests, right? So we will use structural similarity and we'll try to make sure that for any technology where there's a significant difference, we have that data. So to some extent, yes. But yes, we'll also keep in mind the structural similarity because these tests really take a lot of time and resources. So we'll keep focus on providing that for as much product as possible. But same time, we will also focus on structural similarity so we can get more meaningful and useful data.
Okay, I think we have time for one last question. Will there be any board level reliability tests?
It's a good one, yes. Especially with CC pack being top side and bottom side cooled, this is a question we have been asked and we have been discussing that internally as well. So we have actually put a whole series of tests and we are doing a lot of work at the moment. Hopefully when we release this product, you will see a lot more information which will share. So yes, we are doing a lot of board level reliability tests And the moment, the time we release the product, we will share all these results with a wider audience.
All right, thank you. And that actually brings us to the end of this live session. So thank you, Manikant and Giuliano. And if you want to know more about GaN devices, as Manikant also presented, you can follow the research link underneath the screen or chat to one of our power experts, which I would recommend because we did see some final questions come in. And if they're not answered, please use the opportunity with the chat box.
And please stay around. Our next and final live session is the GaN panel talk with industry experts, and we'll start after a short break.